Oh, excellent.
So he took me to his house. So I met him in his house. He gave me permission to go to the shrine, take pictures. I met Femi at a hotel while I was there. Met King Sunny Ade, Majek Fashek. Ross Kimono.
Mm-hmm. And he used to play all this stuff on the radio, and that's how I got like, you know, on the Sundays, you know. And all of a sudden, one Sunday, I like, hey, what's that? Yeah, and it was on, you know.
Yeah. One of the things that you're involved in, what you're doing.
So I started this organization called the African Liberation Lab for Revolutionary Culture, you know, because I thought that, you know, culture was something that was very important to our people, to inspire us, to elevate us, to bring our creativity out so that we can create a better world for ourselves. And so we use a symbol, the symbol was for transformation, and Dinkra symbol for transformation as our symbol, because we felt that we need transformational change.
Mm-hmm.
And when I met Okonta, we were in a group called the African American Youth Organization for Unity. And in that organization, Don and Norma Freeman had a publication called Vibration.
They still got it.
And they sure do. I still get my subscription from it as well. So when that happened, they were looking to awaken the mental and spiritually dead. That was the purpose of their book. And their publication. So I always felt that throughout my life, that was the ultimate for revolutionary struggle, is to awaken the mentally and spiritually dead. And Norma Freeman always instilled in us that the revolution was spiritual first,
mm-hmm.
in order for us to transform yourself into something that would be valuable, to not repeat the same atrocities of colonial rulers, of imperialists, and so that once you understand that and get a higher level, we felt that revolution could happen. And we felt that music was a very important component of that. Fela, of course, was a strong proponent of inspiring people to challenge systems of oppression, challenge systems of imperialism and corruption. And so here we are today.
How did you get involved with this tour?
Teon, yes. I got involved with it because I was doing some concerts with Cahil El-Zabar, this out of this world improvisational sound expert, you know. He introduced me to Arnaud, who was the manager of Sheyun. He said, I think that Sheyun should meet you. I think that what you're trying to do as a young man in inspiring people through music, to take on the duties of our ancestors, the duties that our ancestors said that we should be taking on. This is our generation to take it on. So Cahil said, okay, I want you to introduce you to Arnaud, and I want you to maybe work with Sheyun. And I called him, talked to him, and I said, I got to do it. We tried one time, it didn't work, and then we tried one more time, and here we are.
Because one of the struggle music,
struggle sound, struggle people. Okay, we're rolling.
What is the biggest challenge for you leading your father's band? Leading the band?
Well, I'd say our biggest challenge is economical because of the size of the band.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's kind of difficult financially to produce our tours, you know. I think that's the biggest challenge, you know, for me per se, because, and these days in the music industry, not necessarily how good you are that relates to how well you're getting paid, mm-hmm. or like sports, you know. So music is a popularity contest, not a musical contest anymore,
mm-hmm.
you know. So, yeah, so I think that's the biggest challenge, really. You know, when we tour with a big band, is producing the tours.
Have you created your own shrine? When I was there in 1990, I got a chance to visit.
Well, my brother has a new shrine. My brother built a new shrine, you know, mm-hmm. so yeah, I think that's covered.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah.
How often do you work with Femi?
With him?
Mm-hmm.
Not often, but we do a few shows together.
Mm-hmm.
But I play at the Shrine once a month.
Okay.
When I'm home.
The New Africa Shrine.
Yeah. I call it the Shrine because I always tell you, I don't believe the Shrine can be either old or new.
Mm-hmm.
The Shrine is the Shrine, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I think the New African Shrine for them is like a selling, it's a PR thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know? But for me, I just say the Shrine. You know?
Mm-hmm.
The Shrine doesn't get old.
How difficult is it to, how can I put it? Your father was such an iconic figure, not just musically, but culturally, politically, socially.
Yes.
Not just in Nigeria, but in all of Africa, in the world. So how difficult is it for you? I mean, I like to say the fruit doesn't fall far from the tree. So how difficult is it for you to step into those roles?
Well, for me, I'm really easy. I'm actually really inspired by my dad. I'm truly inspired, but not only by him, but by what he represents and on by the people on whose shoulder he also stands.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because my father wasn't created by himself.
Right.
So,
you talked a lot about your grandma.
Yeah, my grandma, Huma, you know, so many great Pan-Africanist leaders, ancestors, inspired him as well, you know, and being from him, I'm able to understand those people and relate them to his own struggle and be truly inspired, you know. So that for me is what really drives me, is the necessity of what must be done. You know? So yeah, for me that's why I don't really see it as a, you know, something that I had to do, something that I wanted to do. I think, you know, my father inspired a lot of people to not just to want to do the same. I think it's just unfair people ask that kind of question sometimes, just because I'm his son. I'm not allowed to be inspired. I am, you know. So I guess that's it.
And you inspire a lot of people. You
know? Yeah, that's a cycle, isn't it?
Right, and what I appreciate is it's one thing to be your father's son, but it's another thing to be you and to carve out your own space.
Well, you know, my father has always told us that, you know, as long as we believe in what we are doing and respect our heritage, there's always space for us in the world. There's always a place for us to fly in the sky. You know? So, and I've always taken that to heart, you know. And that has always worked itself out also, you know. I've been one who, I've never really wanted much from life or anything, and I believe that because of that I only get what is due to me.
Well, I just want you to know how much we appreciate you. You know, we live in the part of this country where people of your stature, this kind of music doesn't pass through here a lot, but people love it.
Yeah, you know, we come here a lot. I mean, tonight's show wasn't like the best show we've done in the league, and we've done a lot of kind of...
I saw you when you had the Beachland Ballroom.
Yeah, you know, we had, you know, like really good shows here. You know? I don't know what happened tonight. But, you know, yeah, it was a good show musically, but I really thought that was a bit better for
me.
I think we were in a short period of pushing the show. But it was good, you know. For me, it's always good to bring my music to as many people as possible, not just for the entertainment part of it, but for the camaraderie part of it, because, you know, I don't think I have fans. I always say I have people. And my music is an opportunity for my people to meet and we solidify our commitment to what we stand for. It's not just entertainment, you know. So yeah, I'm always happy when I come to town. I see myself as the place where all the Pan-Africanists and revolutionaries and unionists can meet, you know, in a musical atmosphere.
We're just trying to
what they call world music, African music, it hasn't been directed to the African American community. And so one of the things that I've always tried to do was to introduce the music so our people can hear it, you know, because Africa is in us. We don't always know how to recognize it. We don't know how to connect. And so hearing your music and hearing, you know, we can hear the jazz influences in it. We can hear the R&B influences in it. And we hear Africa in it. And so it brings us in.
Yeah, I think in terms of how motherland people all over the world are exposed to music, I think that's purely controlled by the institutions. It's really the media institutions. They are powerful enough to control how music especially is consumed. You know, in my country also, it's difficult for young people to have access to real American music that has a message for them. Mm-hmm. The only American music we hear is the American music that tries to sell us some white supremacist message, or trying to sell us some branded goods, mm-hmm. you know. And I think the only kind of African music that is exposed to African Americans also is that African music that is accepting that narrative, mm-hmm. you know. And there are a lot of political artists here that have a message for Africa. There are a lot of African artists who are political to socially conscious enough to have a message for motherland people here. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the corporations don't want that because we are not selling anything. I really say to people, like, they really don't care, you know. If I could throw in, like, some products in my songs, it would push me, you know, I'm sure of it. Like, it's not really because of what I started, it's just because, like, but what's he selling though? Mm-hmm. You know, they also, you know, for them it's a tit for tat game, you know, you have to sell them for them to sell you, you know? And that's what the TV and the radio, that's what it was created for. Everybody says it's for information. I said, no, the radio and TV has never been created to inform you about nothing. Mm-hmm. It was invented so that they could sell you things in your house, you know, everywhere you go. So, you know, people could sell stuff to you. Mm-hmm. And if you turn on your TV, everything on TV is selling you something. Everything subliminally, directly, so you are being sold something.
I just want you to know your music cuts through that.
Yeah, you know, that's why we keep going. I think that's why we're able to still keep doing what we're doing up until this stage. I mean, you know.
But I know you must be tired, so we're going to let you go.
Yeah, it's been a long day, you know, long tour, but we keep going.
More places to go. Yeah. But really, thank you.
No, my pleasure.
Thank you for talking to us.
No, it's a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Thank you for being here. We have to bring you back.
Definitely, man. Thanks for the hospitality as well. It was really awesome.
Thank you.